Welcome back, this is Narrating Africa. My name is Stephanie Hunteheger. I am here in the main room of the Narrating Africa exhibition. We are today making a second video to show you how the room has changed over the last few weeks. In the previous video, I emphasized changeability as an important factor of the concept of this exhibition. The key idea is that the exhibition room develops over time. And when you last saw this room, the texts and objects that were displayed here were mostly from the 18th, 19th, and early 20th century. The layout of the room reflected this too. So if you remember, the room used to be structured chronologically, so that when you entered it, you first saw the displays that discuss earlier literary texts starting around 1800. And then, as you progressed through the room, you would encounter newer texts and would come out in the early 1960s at the other end. We decided it was time to shift away from that historical perspective and to give the more recent texts more prominence instead. So we reconstructed the exhibition room. Basically, the earlier chronology of the room is now reversed. Before, the first displays that you saw showed you the historically oldest texts. Now it shows the most contemporary one. We would like to use this opportunity to highlight three more exhibition displays. The first one was curated by Annette Bühler-Dietrich, who is a professor of German literature at the University of Stuttgart. She chose to discuss Pinder Diouf's 2018 monodrama Piest. Pinder Diouf is linked to this exhibition project in various ways. We not only currently have this display about her monodrama, but we're also very pleased that Pinder Diouf herself curated a display for us, which we're currently producing and which I hope to be able to show you in our next video. She also very kindly produced a video for us, which is posted on our project website, and in which you can listen to her read several extracts from Piest. Pinder Diouf's autobiographically inspired monodrama draws connections between the discrimination she herself experienced growing up in France with a history of violence in German Southwest Africa. In it, she travels through the Namib Desert and establishes relationships across the limits of time and language. Diouf's impressions of nature, of the dunes of the Namib, are connected with memories of the extermination of the Herero and Nama people during the German colonial era. Piest addresses the German colonization of Southwest Africa, the resistance of the Herero and Nama people, and the subsequent war of extermination against the Nama. In the violence suffered by the Herero and Nama, Diouf finds echoes of the exclusion she herself experienced, as well as racially motivated violent crimes today. History thus becomes available to authors across national borders. It is not, or not only, bound to the countries of their own biographical background. The second table was curated by Doug Henriksen, whom you might remember from our first video. Doug Henriksen is a researcher at the Basler Afrika Bibliographien. He curated this table for us using material from the archive in Basel. It is a selection of theater posters that date from the late 1970s to the new millennium. Let me show you some examples. The Namibian Odysseus was a theater project directed and choreographed by Philippe Talavera and put on stage at the National Theater of Namibia in Windhoek in 2008. And here we have Romeo and Juliet in Namibia, a production that was staged by a German Namibian secondary school in Windhoek, the Deutsche Höhere Privatschule, in 2000. The year before, a theater group called Swakop Munda Macht Theater staged Goethe's Urfaust at the Wehrmann House. And it wasn't the fifth, it was the ninth, a comedy by Italian dramatist Aldo Nicolai, which premiered in 1973 in Heidelberg, was put on stage by the Lions Club at the Haus der Jugend Youth Center in Swakopmund in 1977. What all of these theater productions have in common is that they reference in some form or another European art and works of literature. Homer's epic poem Odysseus, William Shakespeare's famous Romeo and Juliet, Johann Wolfgang von Goethe's tragedy Faust, and Ludwig van Beethoven's 5th and 9th symphonies, the latter of which includes the final 4th movement, Ode to Joy, which serves as the European anthem. But what we can also see from the posters is that this takes different shapes and forms. While some must certainly be labeled as German cultural import into Namibia, others clearly are adaptations that tell first and foremost stories in and of Namibia. Doug Henriksen also included one theatre poster from Switzerland. The play dealt with the violent death of South African anti-apartheid activist Steve Biko in police custody and subsequent trial in the late 1970s. It was entitled Steve Biko's Death, a Trial, and it was staged in Bern in 1988 as a co-production of the local theatre and other organisations, including the anti-apartheid movement in Bern. The examples of these theatre posters raise a lot of questions, and I'm afraid I'm going to end with questions here rather than answers. What do they tell us about apartheid and the German settler society in Namibia, about the post-colonial theatre community in Namibia, or even about the European anti-apartheid movement? From the 1950s onwards, the South African state under the apartheid system invited and financially supported many theatre, opera and concert productions from West Germany, from Switzerland and Austria to South Africa and Namibia. And many European authors, such as Swiss writer Friedrich Dürrenmatt, were translated into Afrikaans. How did literary scholars and German language authors at the time react to these propagandistic cultural policies? The third display I would like to share with you today was curated by Anna Kinder, the director of the research department of the German Literature Archive. The text chosen here is a letter written by a Senegalese author and politician, Leopold Sédar Senghor, written in 1968. In his letter, Senghor accepts the Peace Prize of the German book market. The letter highlights, as Anna Kinder explains, the complex relationship of several connected discourses. And this complexity and interconnection is paradigmatic when discussing the question from which position one might be able to narrate Africa. Who is speaking, who is allowed to speak, and whom are they speaking for? Senghor's name will be familiar to many, particularly in the context of the decolonization debates in the 1930s and early attempts to establish an independent African identity, attempts which later incurred praise but also criticism. Along with Aimé Césaire, Senghor is considered one of the central ideologists of the Negritude movement. In his writing, he advocated the cultural and political independence of Africa, as well as the development of a particular and universal Pan-African identity, distinct from a European identity. Interestingly, Senghor's developing thoughts and ideas were often closely connected to European discourses. Before he became the first president of the Republic of Senegal in 1960, Senghor went to university and later became a school teacher and university lecturer in France, a circumstance that was emphasized by the jury of the Peace Prize of the German book market, who described Senghor as, and I quote, rooted in the source of the African soul, yet formed by a European education. And indeed, if one reads the speech given by Senghor in November 1961 in Frankfurt, entitled The Roots of Negritude, one comes across the names of many European thinkers and scholars: Goethe, Einstein, Sartre, Marx, Kaiserling, Frobenius, to name just a few. Among the documents that we laid out here on the display is a manuscript of the German translation of the speech, as well as a copy of a letter of thanks from Senghor to Friedrich Georgi, the president of the German Publishers and Booksellers Association at the time. We've also added a copy of a German translation of a collection of Senghor's poetry. This collection was published in Heidelberg in 1955. The Marbach Archive also holds a copy formerly owned by German language poet Celan, which was signed by Senghor personally. In our previous video, I mentioned that we had begun to add commentary cards to the displays, and this is a good example. We only recently printed and added this commentary card, written by Urs Büttner, a lecturer at the University of Düsseldorf. Urs Büttner examined in greater detail the correspondence surrounding the 1968 award of the Peace Prize of the German book market, which highlights the insecurities among the German committee members. Today, the original letter is held in the City Archive in Frankfurt, but we received a copy of the letter for our exhibition project. It was written by Siegfried Taubert, who had been in charge of trade fairs and exhibitions for the German Publishers and Booksellers Associations since 1964. And in it, he suggested that the award ceremony should open with readings of Sengor's poetry in German and French. This would be followed by a musical interlude before a speech in praise of Sengor and the actual presenting of the award. For the musical interlude, Taubert suggested, and again I quote, to play West African music or jazz on West African basses. Fearing it would be difficult to find a local orchestra or band that would know how to play African music, however, he recommended playing music off a record. If anything, as Büttner points out, Taubert's letter shows his own uncertainty in staging the event itself. Even if it was kindly meant, his suggestion to play West African music or jazz does not sound as if Taubert really had a concrete idea of what this music could sound like. The association clearly felt this too. They opted for the usual fanfares of classical music instead. So this concludes our second video, and I hope you enjoyed it. Next time we will show you several new tables, which we're producing at the moment. These will be our first step two tables, and we're very excited to be able to add them to the exhibition space. But this is all for today. Thank you for watching.